So thank you all very much for coming today, and we'll talk about discouragement and how to face it, how to grow through it. And this is a subject which is...
Sorry to interrupt, but I just thought of reminding, please keep your mobile phones on silent or off, please. Thank you.
Oh, sorry. I think we need to adjust this. This is going loose. Just check. Okay. This one. How do I move it forward? It's not moving. Okay. Okay, good. Thank you. Thank you. So, discouragement is something which every one of us has experienced. And how do we go about dealing with it? One of the most discouraging moments I remember in my life was, I always wanted to be a public speaker, even before, long before I was introduced. And I was in my school, and I was volunteering for an elocution competition. And what happens to me is, whenever I get nervous, some people when they become nervous, they start stuttering. For me, when I become nervous, I go super fast. So I had prepared a 7-minute talk. And just as I was going on the podium to speak, something within me said, you are going to make a fool of yourself. Later on, I understood when I read the Bhagavad-Gītā, that was the mind saying that. But I just that made me a little nervous. And then I got there and I started speaking. And it's suppose sometimes you enter into a car and the person just drives the car the next moment at 80 or 100. You just get disoriented completely. So my talk started off like that. I just was speaking fast and nobody could understand what I was saying. So people were looking at each other, and because nobody was paying attention, I became more nervous and I spoke faster. And the 7-minute talk, I had probably rehearsed it maybe 50 times before, but that 7-minute talk I finished in 3 minutes. So after that, one of my friends told me, you'll never become a public speaker. So, of course, he attended one of my classes recently. He said, and I'm happy to see my prophecy has gone wrong. But the point is, all of us face discouragements in life. And sometimes those discouragements are because of some mistakes we have made. Sometimes it is because of just situations that turn unfavorable. Sometimes it could be because people have turned hostile to us. So we'll discuss about these various things. Broadly, I'll talk about we have about 4 hours, so we will have a break in between, and I'll be covering 3 main points. Why discouraging situations occur, how to see them, and how to respond to them. So in the first part will be philosophical, but even in philosophy we'll be having some the philosophy with a practical orientation to it, understanding of destiny, that when difficulties or discouragements come in our life, why do they come? So we will understand why discouraging situations occur. Then we'll talk about how can we look at them in a way that is positive, that is resentful, that is not resentful, but that is grateful. Understand our power in that situation also. And the last part will be, how do we respond? So we'll talk about all of these. We'll have one acronym, which will summarize the content of that class, and we'll come to those acronyms. So the last will be an acronym called TAB. So throughout this session, if you have any questions, you have chits over there. You can, if you want to raise your hands, you can raise the hands. But usually at the end of each session and after a significant flow in each session, we will have some questions. And say after an hour or so, we'll have a break. Then we are going to supposed to go to around 3:30. So we'll have 2 or 3 breaks depending on how the sessions move. And one break will be a longer break where we'll have some snacks also. So let's begin. So generally, whenever we face discouragement, it's sometimes we have ourselves not endeavored enough. And then things don't work out. It's still unpleasant, but that's not as discouraging as if we have endeavored a lot and still the results are not coming. Now, we suppose we are giving an interview, giving an exam. We've worked very hard, but the results don't come. That's when discouragement becomes almost unbearable. So, actually, for all of us, just as a car needs fuel to move on, we all need encouragement. Encouragement is the fuel for our heart. We can use different words for encouragement, hope. But what is it that makes me move forward in life? That is, some vision that the future can be better than the present. That's the essence of hope or encouragement. Now, there are different senses to the words, but broadly speaking, we all, whatever we are doing in life, we can move forward when we have that, okay, the future can be better and I can play some part in making that future better. But when our efforts to create a better future fail or worse still backfire, that's when we start becoming discouraged. So why do we need to understand destiny? Because destiny is something which affects how things work out in our life. So we often think that my efforts are going to produce the result. And if my efforts are not producing the result, why is that happening? But if you understand that destiny is also playing a role, then we won't beat ourselves up unnecessarily. So let's look at it. So about destiny, I'll be talking about in four parts. This is another word for destiny is fate. So let's look at the facts of life. We'll begin from that. Then we'll try to analyze those facts of life to understand what we can infer from them. And then we will focus on the transcendence, how there is a higher reality beyond the observed reality. And then expertise is how we can expertly function in our lives based on an understanding of the reality as it is. So what is the fact? So we all want to achieve things in life, but what we achieve in our life depends on factors beyond our control. This is something which maybe in today's world we don't realize it so much. Maybe say a few hundred years ago, for society was much more stratified. So for example, in India there was a caste division, in the Western world there was a class division. So that means the place a person was born would more or less determine the trajectory of their life. So if somebody is born in say royalty, they would have a comfortable life. Somebody was born as a peasant, then they would have a relatively poorer life. And what we call as upward mobility was far lesser in the past. Now that has changed, and in many ways the facility for people to work according to their inspiration is a big plus in today's world. But still the fact remains that our starting point shapes us. And we don't determine our starting point. Which country we are born in, which family we are born in, what complexion we have, some people have outstanding memory. And some people have outstandingly poor memory. So what can you do about it? And that's the way we are. Now, of course, we can do something, but about the memory itself, that is already a given. So like that, if we may say, no, my success depends on my efforts. Well, it's true, but your efforts start from a particular point. And that point is not in your control. So now that point, we could say, is determined by destiny. I'll come to destiny a little later. But let's look at the facts. The facts is that the success that we seek in our life does depend on factors beyond our control. For example, the starting point is not in our control. And our starting point does determine where we will go, how far we'll go. It doesn't completely determine that, but it does affect that. That's one point. So basically, we are looking at the facts to just understand this point that everything in our life is not in our control. And that's why when things go wrong because of factors beyond our control, we needn't become discouraged. So discouragement often comes because we think that we have more control than what we actually have. So understanding what is the level of our control helps us to understand our capacities more realistically. Another fact we could say is, even we leave aside the starting point. And now, right now in my life, I can succeed if I work hard. Yes, our performance matters. But performance is not all that matters. So if we consider somebody is steering a ship. Now, some ships might be very big and sturdy. Some ships might be small and unsteady. So the starting point is already fixed. This is the kind of ship you have. Secondly, a person might be a very expert captain in steering a ship. But if they meet a big storm, then whether they get to their destination on time or whether they get to their destination or not at all, that's not in their control alone. Now, this does not mean that the expertise of the captain doesn't matter. But it is not all that matters. And few activities which are very prominent in our cultural imagination today, few activities are as prominent as sports. And few activities are as performance driven as sports. Say in a cricket match, a batsman or a bowler, they have to perform. If they don't perform, the team will not succeed, they will not succeed. But even in sports matches, actually, performance is not all that matters. Once I was traveling in Mumbai and I saw a big headline on newspaper. So it was the cricketer saying, "I knew God was on my side." Oh, really? I look at the news, what was it? This was this Indian player who had scored a double century. And while scoring the double century, he had miscued a hit. And it had gone to a fielder. And the fielder is not really a very good fielder. And the fielder had somehow dropped the catch. So he said, when he dropped the catch, I knew God was on my side. Now that's a very interesting inference. Now does God take sides in the cricket match? But what he is meaning by the word God is that, see, for his performance, there are things beyond his control also that matter. And those things were going right. That's what he meant by the word God. So it's not that God made that player drop the catch. It's not literally that. But the fact that for our success, along with our performance, there's something which is beyond our performance that matters. And that's why all sports players or many sports players have their own quirky superstitions. About how they bat, what they wear, in what sequence they put on their gear. So many things like that. There was an Australian cricketer. He was quite a good batsman, but whenever he would go out to bat, first he would go to the pavilion restroom and close the lids of all the commodes. And if he would get out early, he would not come back to the pavilion, he would go to the commodes, and if any lid was open, he would go and berate his team members. Why did you keep that open? Because of that I got out. Now, what has the lid got to do with his batting and his getting out? But that is his own way of conceptualizing whether whatever is unknown beyond me, that is favoring me or not. So basically, we can laugh at the superstitions, but the underlying principle is that even in a performance-driven activity like sports, performance is not all that matters. So, this is also another way, from another observed fact, that we can understand that everything that happens in our life is not just about us. So now let's try to make some analysis from this. This will be based on the dharmic text, primarily the Mahabharata. So for us to get a result, a desired result, there are three distinct factors involved. In Sanskrit, we can call as karma, daiva and phala. Sorry, kala. Karma, daiva and kala leads to phala. In English, we might call use it the 4D. So we have our duty, that is karma. We have destiny, that is daiva. We have kala, that is duration. So duty, destiny, duration. All three, when they come together, there is the desired result. So often we think that my karma leads to the phala. I have worked, so I should get the result. And when we don't get the result, we become discouraged. But if you understand that other things are going on in life also, then we can respond to situations with greater maturity. By the way, if this mic tends to be a little too humble, so it keeps sliding down. If any of you are not able to hear me, please raise your hands and then we will either adjust the sound or adjust the mic. Till now, everybody was able to hear?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So let's look at a few examples to understand this point. A simplest example could be, say, farming. That when a farmer sows the seed and plows the land, that is the duty. Then rains come on time in the right quantity, that is destiny. And then the harvesting season comes. Time has to pass, lesser duration. And that's when the harvest can be got. Or we could say, if a couple gets married and then decides to have children, now they unite, that is the duty. That is the karma. But that alone doesn't always lead to conception. So then there is destiny. And then even if conception has occurred, they can't have a child the next day. There is the period of gestation. So that's duration. So duty, destiny and duration, all three combine to produce the result. So now, if we neglect these two facts, the destiny and the duration, then we have an unrealistic expectation. Now this, sometimes this destiny and duration, they might actually even become invisible. What do you mean by invisible? Sometimes some actions might just give immediate results. Say for example, if there's a banana peel spilled over, lying on the ground, and if I walk on it, I'll fall down. Now, that's just immediate action, immediate reaction. So we could say that there, oh, I was inattentive and I slipped and fell down. If I had been attentive, I would have avoided that. Now, that's true. So many times it could be that these two may become almost invisible. But it's not necessary like that. Just let's complicate the situation a little bit. Say there are three banana peels fallen on the ground and three people are walking along. And first person steps on it, slips and just falls on the ground and nothing is hurt except their pride. The second person, that the person slips on the banana peel, but there is a tree branch over it, just grab it and they don't even slip and fall. The third person, they step on a banana peel, slip and fall, and where their head falls, there's a sharp stone over there and they hit the stone and that person gets brain hemorrhage. So now you could say all three did a small same mistake. But why did one person get such a terrible result? So here, even in situations where you could say A to B, simple correlation is there, but it need not be always like that. So sometimes a small mistake can lead to a big catastrophe. And sometimes a big mistake might also not lead to any problems. And most often what happens, our mind is quite selective in its memory. So we keep remembering all the times when we made a small mistake and still got into big trouble. We think, oh, life is so unfair. But then if we all can think in our times when we made big mistakes, but we got away with it, isn't it? So overall, we can say that destiny evens out. But the point I'm making over here is that sometimes destiny and duration may not become visible. Say another example we could give is, normally we eat food and we get energy. Mm-hmm. Now, if we eat too much food, then either we fall sick or we become obese or various other things happen. So normally we could say that, say if somebody is overweight, that's because they've eaten too much. But it's not necessarily always like that. Now, there are some people who might be genetically disposed towards obesity. Some people might have some thyroid issue or whatever. If they eat a little bit more, their body balloons out. There are some other people who might be very healthy. Their body is constitutionally very healthy. They treat their tongue like a conveyor belt. They eat anything and everything, and still they remain not only healthy, slim, attractive, nothing happens to them. So, we could say there is a normal correlation between what we eat and how our health and looks are. But sometimes destiny can intervene in an unfavorable way, where a small indiscretion can lead to a lot of trouble. And sometimes it can intervene in a favorable way, that even a lot of indiscretion and no trouble. So, but the point is that many times these factors may not be evident. And that's why we may think my action is producing the result. And it's true to some extent, but it's not always true. It's like, say, we eat food and we get energy. That's natural. But then there is the whole digestive process that has to happen in between. Now, most of the time, this is invisible. We eat food, we digest the food, we get energy. The only time we think about our digestion is when it doesn't work. So when karma doesn't lead to phala, then we start thinking, what is happening? Then either we can just get frustrated thinking life is so unfair, or we can become more philosophical. It was Socrates who said that. He was asked once, should you marry? Should we marry? He says, yes. If you are fortunate, you will get a good wife. If you get a good wife, you are fortunate. And if not, then you will become a philosopher.
Well, it is not just about a wife, it could be about any spouse.
But the point is that actually when we don't get the expected results, that is when we start thinking, what is going on in life? Is something wrong over here? So that's when we start thinking about life's deeper truths. You become a philosopher means basically you start thinking about philosophically about what is happening in life. See, karma leads to phala, is action leads to result, is a practical way of thinking. But when action doesn't lead to result, that's when we start thinking about philosophy. See, most people don't suddenly wake up and start thinking, is there a God? We don't start thinking about God suddenly. We basically look at the world around us and we observe the world, and then if we feel that we can't make sense of the world, that's when we think about God. So Prabhupada writes that all knowledge comes from God. That means God is present in our hearts as a super soul. So all knowledge comes from God. But all knowledge doesn't begin with God. It's not that people suddenly start thinking about God. We look at the world around us and we try to make sense of the world. And when we can't make sense of the world, then we start positing higher realities to make sense of the world. So basically, our actions do have results. But sometimes the results may not manifest. And sometimes even with a small action, a big result may manifest. So duty, destiny, duration. Now, for getting the desired result, sometimes, say for example, if my body is overall healthy, then I eat food and I get energy. So in that case, duty is what I do, and destiny is almost invisible over there. And duration is, okay, I eat food, 15 minutes later I feel strong. So at that time it might be very less. So sometimes destiny and duration might just be 1%, and duty might be 99%. And sometimes duty might be 1%, and it means I do everything that I can. But sometimes you fall sick, and if you fall sick, and then you're trying to diagnose and trying to get some treatment and nothing is working. You're trying, but if destiny is not favorable, you may not even diagnose the disease. About 15 years ago, I was very sick for almost 2-3 years and nobody could diagnose the disease. So then finally, I did some test like a very complicated test. And then a doctor, I looked at a doctor's paper, I was going to meet the consultant, but I looked at the paper, he said that it's P-U-O. I thought, what is this disease? At least I thought some disease has been found out. And then I asked the doctor, what is the diagnosis? He said, oh, actually, you've not been able to diagnose. Oh, really? But then I said, P-U-O. This P-U-O means pyroxia of unknown origin. The pyroxia is fever, and fever for no, we don't know the cause. Well, that I also know, I said. So, sometimes we might do everything that we can, but nothing seems to move forward. So in that case, our duty becomes almost like 1% or less than 1%, and destiny just blocks everything. So understanding this can give us a better perspective of what is happening in our life. So a diagrammatic way of looking at this. Can you see it from there or no? Okay, there are no tables over here. But there are some chairs here. If you want, you can. If you want, you can come here. Some chairs are there here. Are you able to see from there or no? Okay. Yeah. So basically, what I said, the same thing over here. See, our current actions and the current reactions or the current results. Sometimes it might just be a straight line. I do the action and I get the result. So in that case, destiny and duration hardly play any role. Now sometimes there might be some delay. I do the action, but it takes some time to get the result. I keep trying this, I try that, I try that, I try that, and then I get the result. Sometimes it might happen that my current action might lead to a long, might go through a long cycle. So it's like, this is basically the metaphor of a water tank. Thank you. So this is a metaphor of a water tank. The water is going in from this side and water is coming out from the other side. But if you consider inside the water tank, there are multiple pipelines. So then sometimes the water which is going in, it might go straight through the pipeline and come out from the other side. Sometimes it might go through a wavering pipeline. So it may take a longer time to come out. Sometimes it might go through a long oscillating pipeline. So that's why now I might be putting in, say, clean water from here. But sometimes clean water may come out from the other side. Sometimes unclean water may be coming out. Because water coming out is not what is going in right now. So what is being put in will come out eventually, but maybe not immediately. So this is one broad way of understanding the concept of destiny. So immediate karma, delayed karma, further delayed karma. Actions and reactions as we are moving forward. So basically, when we do something and we don't get the result, what that means is that water is flowing through a delayed pipeline. And we are working, but the result is not coming to us. So now, moving forward here, another way of looking. So there are, what happened? Okay. So based on this understanding, you can say there are broadly two schools of thought. In Sanskrit, they are called as Daivavad, and the other is Karmavad. Daivavad in English can be called as fatalism. Daivavad holds that nothing is in my control. Already destiny has determined my whole life, and I can do nothing about it. Karmavad is that everything is in my control. If I work, I will produce the result. So going back to the earlier four factors, what Karmavad says is karma alone matters. Daivavad says that daiva alone matters. So some people say that, my destiny is only rotten. My destiny is rotten. I cannot do it. We have no free will. We are all just puppets of destiny. And destiny makes us dance the way we want. So I was once in America, in New York. So one person asked me this question. He says that, actually, we have no free will. Everything is destined. So he said, and I said, okay. Do I have the free will to answer this question? So he said, no, whatever you answer will be destined. Okay. Then I said, then why are you asking this question? He said, my asking this question is also destined. Okay. Then then the point remains, if everything is destined, if you say like that, we can go along in the self, this kind of reasoning, but we never live like that. What do you mean we don't live like that? See, we do strive. We do strive to do things as well as we can. It's nobody lives as if everything is destined. If we were living like that, what would be the motivation to do anything at all? Whatever is destined is going to happen. So, why would you even try to cook food and eat the food? You can say, if it is destined, I will stay in my bed, the food will come in my mouth and drop it. It doesn't happen like that. So, for practical matters, we never say everything is destined. Isn't it? So, it's going to come philosophical matters, like say, please come to a temple, please come to a temple, please come to a spiritual program. Oh, when destiny says, then I'll come. So, it's for practical matters, we never say that. So, that idea that everything is destined is not something which we live according to. And everything is in my control is what we may believe for some time. But even a little experience of life shows us that everything is not in my control. So these could be two extreme ideas. And broadly speaking, we can say that Eastern civilizations tend towards Daivavad. Not Daiva, they are not entirely Daivavad, but they tend towards Daivavad. That accept. A lot is not in your control, so accept it. Western civilizations tend toward Karmavad. That, no, change it. Change it. You can fix it. You can change it. You can make things better. Now, both have their value, both have their utility, but extremes can be a problem. So now, Vidura tells Dhritarashtra in the Mahabharata that when Dhritarashtra is reluctant to stop his son Duryodhan from antagonizing the Pandavas and causing the Kurukshetra war, at that time Dhritarashtra says that if it is destiny, then all my sons will be killed. If our dynasty is to be destroyed by destiny, what can I do to stop it? He says that, so at that time Vidura says destiny determines the consequences of our actions, not our actions themselves. So that means if I study for an exam, whether I study for the exam or not is not determined by destiny. After studying, how much marks I get, what kind of grade I get, that is determined by destiny. It's not that we are the knowledge of, so destiny and duty are not two contradictory factors. Because I believe in this, so I don't believe in this. No, both work together. And mostly people go toward the extreme. Oh, if you think destiny is there, then why do you work? Or if you start believing in destiny, then you will not work wholeheartedly. No, we understand what is the role of our work and what is the role of destiny. So, Daivavad, if it is taken towards extreme, it leads to passivity. Just accept whatever is happening. In fact, this is how I think it was the Mayan civilization in South America that was brought down by the Spanish invaders, the Catholics or Christians invaders who went there. Basically, they had one of the biggest tribes over there. They had a story. They had a legend that if on a no moon night, if a riderless white horse comes into our village, then that is indicate that we are going to be defeated soon. So there was one missionary who joined with them, started giving them medicines, and became friendly with them. And gradually, as they became friends, the Mayans, they told this about this legend to him. And immediately, he informed the imperialists. And South Americans, they were numbered in thousands. And the Spanish who had come there, they were just barely a few hundred. But they arranged for a horse to come into that village on a no moon night, a white horse, riderless. And the next morning, these few hundred imperialists, colonialists, they invaded the village. And they invaded that whole community. And they just surrendered without a fight. because they thought, oh, this is an indication we are going to be defeated. So this can be very cynically abused also. Where do I do this one? Okay. So Daivavad is unhealthy. It can make us unnecessarily passive. But Karmavad is also unhealthy. Because what happens when we... anger has various expressions. Anger, when it is directed toward the world, it leads to violence. Anger, when it is directed towards oneself, leads to depression. Why am I not good enough? Why is my life not good enough? Why can't I come up to the mark? So when we believe only in Karmavad, we think that I determine the success in my life. Then what happens? If I take the sole credit for the success in my life, then I have to take the sole blame for the failure in my life. And sometimes it may not be my fault. We're not saying that we shouldn't take responsibility. There's a difference between taking responsibility and blaming oneself. I'll talk about responsibility in the last part of our talk. But here, blaming ourselves, we simply beat ourselves down. So life has been tough throughout history. In fact, in the past, we could say without the comforts of today, life was tougher. But we don't hear in the past thousands and thousands of people getting depressed. Isn't it? Why is it that now it is happening? Now, of course, depression is a complex phenomena, and sometimes there's clinical depression which might require medication. But broadly speaking, depression is a function of expectation. The higher the expectation we have from life, when life doesn't turn out that way, we start getting depressed. So, Karmavad raises our expectation from ourselves and from the world very high. It says, I will work in this field and I will be a top-notch success. And if I can't succeed, then I start thinking, I am a failure, I am worthless, I am useless. But this can happen with respect to our career, it can happen with respect to our relationships, it can happen with respect to our own hobbies or whatever. In any area, if we start with thinking that I determine the results, or rather I alone determine the results, then when the results don't come, we go into a depression. So broadly speaking, we could say that our topic, we are discussing about discouragement. So discouragement can come, one major reason could be because we overemphasize karma. We overestimate our capacity to change things, to do things. And because of that excessive expectation, when things don't work out, we become depressed. We become disheartened. We become discouraged. Okay. So, any questions till this point? Okay, so let me complete this. What is the acronym we are discussing? Does anyone remember? Fate. So, okay. F was what? Facts. We look at the facts that we alone don't determine the results. Then A was? Analysis. We discussed how we can analyze based on Shastra, based on the Vedic text, that there are three factors, three which shape the results. Karma, Daiva and Kala. So now let's move on to transcendence. Transcendence means that what scripture tells us is that destiny can, so our existence is three levels. There's a body, mind and soul. Now destiny can affect our physical situation and it can affect our mental situation. But destiny doesn't affect us as souls because the soul is transcendental. So destiny operates within the arena of matter. It operates within the arena of material things. In the 13th chapter of the Bhagavad-Gita and 21st text, Krishna says, Karya karana kartrutve hetu prakritruchyate purusha sukha dukkhanam bhoktrutve hetu ruchyate. He says that what happens in material nature is determined by material nature. But how it affects us depends on our conceptions, depends on how we are viewing ourselves. So, transcendence, transcendental knowledge begins by understanding, if I understand I'm a soul, at the core, there is something to me which exists beyond my situations and beyond my emotions. And that core is indestructible. So imagine if there is a flood. Actually, this happened to one of my friends. He was in Florida. He had gone for a writing retreat. And there was one of the biggest hurricanes which hit America. It was Hurricane Irene. So it hit Florida. And when it hit there, Florida, because he was a writing retreat, there was no one with him, and he was living in somebody else's house, which he had just got for a month or so. So he was just all alone. And one morning he woke up and he tried to turn on the power. Power wouldn't turn on. Then he tried to look at his phone. Phone had no signal. And then he opened the window, and he saw, it seems he was in the middle of ocean. All around was water. And he could see nearby houses were also flooded. And as he saw that the water level was rising. And it was just like a small house, one level. And I saw the water level rising. He became panicky. What do I do? And there was nobody anywhere in sight. And the water level was rising, becoming panicky. But suddenly he looked around. He said, where do I go? And because he had been so caught in writing and reading and thinking, he had not even really investigated the house much. So he saw somewhere, he had thought it was just a closet. It's a wooden door. He thought, hey, let me look at that. And he opened the door and he found there's a narrow staircase. And that led to a small attic. So he just ran up and went to the attic. And he stayed in that attic, and the water level rose. And the ground level was inundated. And it would be out of from the attic window, he could see TV sets and computers floating in the water outside. Yeah. But because he was at that level one, he was safe. And after that, the water subsided. And then rescue workers came and he was saved. So the point here is that if he had stayed at the ground level, he would have drowned. But he discovered, oh, there is an attic. And he went to that level and he survived. So similarly for us, if we stay at the ground level, that means we stay in material consciousness. We could say our existence is material and spiritual. Body is material, the soul is spiritual. Now, for most of the times, we live at the material level of reality. But that's where we stay stuck always. Then when, because of unfavorable destiny, some distresses come and hit us, if that's all we know about ourselves, we'll get drowned. But if you understand, I am a soul. I am indestructible. That's like finding the staircase to go to a higher level. Now, what happens at the lower level still matters. You know, his computer was there, his luggage was there. He's concerned about it. But our luggage getting damaged is not the same as we getting drowned. It's a different category of problem. So similarly, if we understand our transcendence, then we understand that we exist above our situations and above our emotions. And destiny determines our circumstances. But if we understand our transcendence, then we start understanding that our circumstances are like a carpet. The carpet is meant to be below us. What happens if the carpet goes above us? Two things: darkness and suffocation. So like that, when our circumstances overwhelm us, and if we feel dark, we feel hopeless, and we feel suffocated, we just can't do anything. So transcendental knowledge is not just some hypothetical idea, okay, maybe there is something called soul. Actually, this practical application of it is that we raise our consciousness above our situations and our emotions. So this is where our spirituality can help us to deal with negative destiny whenever it comes upon us. I'll talk more about this as we move forward, but this is about transcendence. Now, moving forward from the transcendental perspective, destiny, so if I am transcendental, that means I have free will. If I were simply a product of my situations and my emotions, then there's no free will. This is how things happen. If this happens to me, I'll do this. If that happens to me, I'll do that. But nobody functions as if they have no free will. Suppose, say, the person sitting next to you suddenly turns to you and slaps you in the face. Why did you slap me? He said, no, actually, I am just a biological robot. So, the programming of my brain told me to slap you. Then probably we'll say, my programming is telling you to slap you now. See, none of us, our whole society depends on the concept of responsibility, accountability. The justice system is based on understanding that people are accountable for their actions. So nobody functions as if people don't have free will. So now we can say our free will itself, is it fully free? We can say the free will is free, but there is free will and there is freedom. The two are different things. A prisoner also has free will, but the prisoner doesn't have freedom. Or their freedom is very less. That means they can only, if they want to go for a walk, they can only walk inside the prison. They cannot go out. So free will is our capacity to choose. Our inner capacity to choose. And freedom is the outer circumstance in which we can choose. So destiny determines the scope of our free will. The scope means, say if somebody is sick and is in bed, bedridden, say they have got a fracture or something like that, they can't move. Then destiny determines that, has determined that, okay, they can't get out of the bed now. But on the bed, what do? They can just complain. Or they can have a positive attitude. So destiny determines the scope of our free will, not our free will. Because we are transcendental beings, so our free will exists beyond our situations and our emotions. And we can choose. And we'll talk more about how to use our free will properly a little later. But let's focus on this point now. So another thing that understanding of our transcendence does is, we understand that, okay, destiny can only block me materially. Okay, I can't do this, I can't do that, I can't do that. But it doesn't have to block us spiritually. So what does it mean? Say if a river is flowing along and if the river path is blocked, then the river can't move forward. But if there is some other path from which the river can move, then it can move onward. There's another channel, another tributary along which the water can move. Distributor, you could say, then the water will move. So our spirituality reveals to us one channel that is always open. Other channels might get blocked. I may have no money, I may have no health, I may have no relation, no relatives, but still, with whatever little consciousness I have, I can remember Krishna. And I can keep moving closer to Krishna. So our spirituality reveals, no matter how many blockages are there in our life, our transcendence, our spirituality reveals that there is one channel that is always open. And then we can move along that channel. All this, see this T and E, what I'm going to talk about here. Here we are talking about principles and how to apply that practically. We'll be talking in the next sessions. But this is T. Now let's go to E. Now the essence of expertise, we're talking about fate. So, what is the expertise? That there is destiny and there is karma and there is daiva. So we all need to understand with our expertise what is in our control and what is not in our control. And accept the things we can't change and alter the things we can change. Now we might say this is common sense. Yeah, it is, but as they say, common sense is not so common. So our mind gets obsessed with the things that we can't change. And that's where we lose our opportunity. So let's consider two examples of why expertise is required for this. Say, consider a tennis match. And now in tennis, the players sometimes serve and sometimes they receive. Now when a player is serving, at that time the player has much more control. You know, whether to serve on the forehand, the backhand, into the body, how much speed, how much height. They can control all that. Now when the player is returning, they have very little control. Wherever the ball comes, you have to somehow get the racket over there and get the ball back into play. Now the returner might be very good in the forehand. But if the ball has come on the backhand, the returner says, no, my forehand is strong, I'll play on the forehand. Well, you'll only hit empty air at that time. So when you're returning, the area of control has become very less. What is out of our control, where the ball is going to come is out of our control. So sometimes in our life, what we can change is very little and what we can't change is a lot. So if a player who is returning starts wanting to play like as if they are serving, they'll get nowhere. They'll lose that game immediately. But they understand, okay, right now I'm returning, right now my choices are constricted. But within this, how can I return as well as possible? Now, there are many Grand Slam champions whose primary strength was they were expert returners. Just return expertly and by that, they would win matches. So basically, expertise is required to understand in our life when we are serving and when we are returning. So, as a simple example to illustrate these differences, say right now I'm giving a class. So, when I am giving the class, I will choose the topic, I'll choose the examples, I will choose the flow, I'll choose the structure. So, when I'm giving the class, I'm serving. Now, after this class, when the question answers start, then I'll be returning. Isn't it? I don't know which question is going to come. I don't know how well I'll be able to answer it. I'll just try my best. Now, if while returning, if when I am supposed to return, somebody asks a question which answer I don't know, and I say, why are you asking such a question? Shut up. If I start speaking like that, I'll be insulting my audience. You know, I can't demand what questions the audience should ask me. That time I have to return. But if suppose I come for this class, and after I come for the class, I tell you, okay, no, I have not prepared anything. Whatever topic you tell me, I'll speak on that. You will start thinking, why did I come here? Isn't it? So, there is a time when we need to take control and do what we can using the control that we have. And there's a time when we have to accept that things are not in our control and just work with that. So, we could say, if you decide that after you complete your degree and you decide, you have now 2-3 choices. Should I study more? Should I take a job? Or should I start my own company or whatever? Now, this is the time when you're deciding. You could say that's the time when you're serving. But if somebody decides that I'm going to study more now, then once they decide that, then to some extent, for the next 1 year or 2 year, whatever, depending course, their trajectory will be fixed. And that's when they will be returning. Okay, now I've chosen to study, then I have to submit my assignments, I have to give exams, all that I have to do. So for all of us, this is this dynamic dance between what is in our control and what is not in our control. And we need expertise to deal with that. So I'll conclude with two examples over here. Let's see how far is it. Yeah. Okay. So, in the Bhagavatam, in the 10th canto, there is a very interesting anecdote, incident. But what happens, most of you may have seen that picture of Kamsa holding the hair of Devaki and about to lop off her head. And Vasudev is holding that, stopping her, don't do this. So, when Vasudev is trying to stop Kamsa, he uses various arguments at that time. And one argument that he uses is, Kamsa, birth and death are destined. Why do you, if you're going to die, you can't avoid that. But why should you commit such a horrible karma of killing Devaki. It's like, you know, there is sin, there is sin square, and there is sin cube. So what Kamsa was about to do was sin cube. Why sin cube? He says, it's, you know, for somebody's hero is meant to protect women, not kill women. You know, women are not even meant physically assaulted, what to speak of killed. So that itself is sin. On top of that, this is not just any woman, this is his own sister. He's all the more duty bound to protect her. So killing her is sin square. And on top of that, it is the day of her wedding. On that day, you kill her, what can be more monstrous? So it's sin cube, he says. Why are you doing such a terrible activity to avoid something which can't be avoided? Destiny is there, you want to die, you want to die. Now when I read this for the first time, I immediately had a question. Why is Vasudeva not turning this argument around and thinking, I am trying to stop Kamsa from killing Devaki, but if Devaki is destined to die, she is going to die no matter what I do. He doesn't think like that. He doesn't think, why am I wasting my time arguing with Kamsa? Kamsa is going to kill him. If Devaki is going to die, she will die. He doesn't think like that because he's focused on his duty. As a husband, he's meant to protect his wife. So he does not use the idea of predestination. Predestination is that everything is destined. He does not use that as a rationalization for inaction. And the same principle we can see in the Ramayana also. When Ram was sent to the forest, he accepted the exile as destiny. But he did not fight against his father or fight against Kaikeyi. He accepted it. But when Sita was abducted, he didn't accept that as destiny. He fought against it. Why? Because his duty as a son meant that he should obey his father. So he went to the forest. But his duty as a husband meant he had to protect his wife. So he had to rescue her. So the overall emphasis is that we need to expertly understand what is our duty and focus on doing that. So let's conclude with this one point over here, and we'll elaborate on the next session now. We don't know what the future holds, but we know who holds the future. That the future is ultimately determined by Krishna. He holds the future, and if we learn to hold on to him, then he will help us create a better future for ourselves. So the expertise is to understand this balance. What is in my control? What is not in my control? What should I do? What should not do? If we can understand, if we can connect with Krishna, then Krishna from within our hearts will give us the guidance. Tadami buddhi yogam tam yena mam upayantite. He'll give us the intelligence by which we can come to him. And that way, we can use whatever free will right now we have, whatever is in our control, we can use it to create a better future for ourselves. So, to summarize what I spoke today, we're talking about overcoming discouragement. I started by talking about we are going to discuss why discouraging situations come upon us, understanding destiny, then how we see them. That is why we'll talk about cultivating gratitude in the next session, and then how we act in them, how we respond to them. That is, open a new tab in your life. We'll talk about tap your power. We'll talk about that in the last session. So then I talked about the concept of destiny. That now we looked at the acronym. Does anyone remember? Fate. So F was facts. That we look at the facts of our life. Our results don't come from our actions alone. A person might steer a ship expertly, but if the storm comes, what can they do? A sports player may play very well, but if it rains and the match doesn't happen, what can they do? So performance matters, but performance is not all that matters. Then if something beyond us shapes the results, then what exactly is that and how does it shape the results? So to understand that, we looked at A was analysis. I talked about the equation. Does anyone remember? What is it? Karma leads to phala. Yes. In English, duty plus destiny leads to desired result. We discussed various examples of, say, a farming or conception, or say somebody slipping on a banana and falling. So sometimes in these three factors, which will be in what proportion, that can vary. Sometimes the other two, the duration and destiny, might almost become like zero. And sometimes they might become 99%. And everything that we do, it doesn't seem to change things. But essentially, all three factors are there. And if we understand this, then if the results are not coming, we don't blame ourselves for it. Then we talk about that diagram, which shows how water coming in, water going out. So what we do does shape the results. Or does it, what our actions do have reactions or results, but maybe not immediately. Sometimes it might be a long coiling pipe through which the water is flowing. So we might gravitate toward two extremes. To some extent, some Eastern traditions or some traditions went towards Daivavad, overemphasizing that everything is destined, nothing is in our control. But that can lead to passivity, as I talked about the South American example of how they were colonized by sending a white horse. So, but we said that the dharmic traditions, the Indian tradition, is not fatalistic, because we talked about how Dhritarashtra told Vidura that you can determine, that destiny determines the consequences of our actions, not your actions themselves. So Daivavad is one extreme which can lead to passivity. The other extreme is Karmavad, which can lead to depression. If I take sole credit for my successes, then I have to take the sole blame for my failures. And people have always had difficulties in life, but now because our expectations have risen, I think I determine my life. Then when I'm not able to determine, we become depressed. And then we talk about how do we, okay, once we understand that destiny is operating in our lives, then what do? We can't change the way things are happening, but we can rise above those things. That's what we talked about was T, transcendence. I give the example of my friend who discovered an attic on a first level and was able to go up during the floods. So like that, if we understand we are souls, then we can rise above our situations and above our emotions. We're still concerned about what happens at the physical and mental level, but we don't feel that personally threatened by it. But by our transcendence, we can keep our circumstances like carpets below us, not above us, where they will blind and suffocate us. And transcendence also means that we have our free will. Destiny determines the scope of our free will, but we still have free will. And E was? Expertise. Expertise essentially means accept the things we can't change and alter the things we can change. And he talked about tennis match, where there are times when our control might be very less when we are returning, but our control will be more when we are serving. So understanding what situation we are in and doing the best we can in that situation, that is the expertise with which we can function in our day-to-day lives. And then lastly, he talked about this expertise in come if we look beyond the situation to Krishna. Rather than worrying about what the future holds, we look up to see who holds the future. And focus on connecting with Him, then Krishna has a plan for our future also. And if we connect with Him, He will guide us to play our part in the unfolding, in the manifestation of the plan that He has for us in future. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So are there any questions right now? Yes, Prabhu.
Thank you very much for a very nice session. You were indicating this results is determined by karma, daiva, and phala. So, and kala, that is the time.
Yeah.
So many times, several times we have something called indicators of results as well. Like while the process itself is going on, we get the indicators.
That's true.
Something like what we feel is that what the results is going to be. So to what extent we should give importance to the indicators? So if you say that okay, don't worry about destiny, we put in the effort, put in our best efforts, and the results is determined by them, determined by the Lord, and determined by karma and daiva and kala. So to what extent we take give importance to the indicators of what the future is going to be?
Okay, good question. To what extent do we give importance to the indicators of future results? We definitely are meant to use our intelligence. And using our intelligence is a part of doing our karma. So that's where actually we have, say, professionals in any field. Say, I might just feel some fever, but a doctor might say, you got malaria. And for me, this is just maybe fever and some chills. But the doctor with the educated eyes can see and they understand. So that's why having the intelligence to understand the feelers, that is important. So if I'm just feeling chills, I could say maybe it's just too cold, or maybe I ate something cold, I can neglect it. So but if there's a doctor with me and the doctor friend tell me, you know, better you get checked for malaria, and I do that, and maybe I can prevent the malaria from getting aggravated because I check it earlier. So basically how it is, okay, this was a concept I was going to talk in the last session, but I'll mention it here. We all need to place situations in the right context. What do I mean by the right context? Say for example, right now, if the screen goes off. Now, we could say that this screen has gone off. There could be multiple levels of causation for it. Maybe, you know, somebody touched the wire over there, because of that the screen went off. Mm-hmm. Or maybe somebody, the projector itself has got damaged. So we could put it in one box. Okay, that this connection is loose. Other box is, oh, the projector has got spoiled. Another box could be that the power supply has got cut off over here. Oh, another box you could put is that actually the power grid over here in this part of the country has gone down. Another box you could put in is a terrorist have attacked New Zealand and all power supply has gone. Another box you could put in is that a solar flare has come from the sun's orbit into the sun into the earth atmosphere and all electrical devices on the planet earth have shut down. Now that's also possible. Actually, if a solar flare comes from the sun and it enters into the earth, that can happen. All now, just a simple thing as a projector getting off, that we can extend the causal context to that of that to the solar flare from to the sun thousands and thousands of miles away. So basically now, where do you put this? We need to use our intelligence to understand which causal context to put a situation in. Say, actually I was at a conference in America on spirituality and health. And there's one girl who was speaking over there about how she went into depression and how spirituality helped her to get out of it. But then she told how she went into depression. Since she was studying in a college, and while studying in the college, along with that, she was also to earn some money by the side, she used wait tables in a cafeteria nearby. So once she was carrying a glass of water for a customer, and that glass slipped from her hands. And it just fell with a loud noise and spilled and cracked. And she says, because of that incident, she started thinking, I'm so useless, I can't carry even a glass of water. What will I do in my life? And that made her sink into depression. Now how many of us have had glass of water slipping from our hands? So many times it has happened. So now when the glass of water slips from the hand, now you could put the causal context in various different ways. You know, maybe the glass was slippery. Maybe my hand was also wet. Maybe the floor was slippery, that's why it slipped out of my hand. Maybe somebody spoke loudly and that's why I got distracted. Or you could say, maybe I was inattentive. But to think that I am worthless because of that. So what has happened? When people go into depression or any mental health problem usually, what happens is their intelligence doesn't function properly. So they take a stimulus and put it in the most damaging causal context. Some people are paranoid of fear. Paranoid with fear. They hear some noise at night and somebody has come to murder me. They become paranoid. So now that noise might come because of so many other reasons. So basically, intelligence means to put things in the most constructive context. Now it's not, here we're not talking about right or wrong. It is, which is the most constructive context. Say right now I'm speaking. Now, sometimes when I give a class, the audience starts looking at me as if they are watching a foreign language movie without subtitles. Now, when that sort of expression comes on their face, now I could put that in various causal contexts. I could say that maybe what I'm speaking is a little difficult, or I could say that if I put it in that context, maybe what I'm speaking is very complicated, then I'll simplify it. Or if I start thinking this audience is dumb, then I will get annoyed and I just want to walk away from there. Or if I start thinking that, you know, people are not interested in spirituality at all. So what am I doing sharing spiritual knowledge? I'm just wasting my time. Then I might become disheartened about giving any class in the future also. So basically, whenever any situation comes in our lives, we need to think and put it in the most constructive context. So yes, if you're getting some feelers, okay, if I'm going to do this, this is what is likely to happen. Then try to put it in the most constructive context. Okay, so does this indicate I should not do this? If I'm not going to do this, maybe let me consult some other people who are experts. And based on that, let me understand. So it is possible that sometimes we realize that we are in a sinking ship. And then, okay, the water is coming, it's sinking. What do I do? And now I have to get out of it. So if I don't get out, then I'll drown, I will sink with it. But I need to get out. So definitely looking at feelers is important. If you look at the Kurukshetra war, now there are times when Krishna told Arjuna, withdraw. At one time Bhima, Ashwatthama attacked the Pandavas with the Narayanastra. And as Narayanastra was such a powerful weapon that nobody could counter it. And the more it was countered, the stronger it would become. So when that weapon started charging, and Arjuna was fighting, Yudhishthira was fighting, but it was just becoming burning higher and higher and higher. And everybody was getting overwhelmed. So at that time Krishna told, we cannot counter this weapon. This is Narayan's weapon. The only thing you can do when Narayan comes is bow down. Is all of you bow down on the war field. Lie down on the ground, put aside your weapons. The weapon will whiz above your head and it will go away. When it doesn't find any opposition, it will go away. Now everybody bowed down except for one person. Can you guess? Ashwatthama was shooting. From the Pandava side, who is one person who is very proud and angry and mean? He kept fighting. And he said, all of you, I thought you are warriors, you become cowards? Just because a weapon seems dangerous, you are putting down your weapons? What kind of warriors are you? And he kept fighting. Now when the Narayanastra did not find any target, it just attacked him. And he was too proud to bow down, but his whole body caught fire and was burning. So at that time Krishna and Arjuna saw that, and Arjuna shot the Varunastra towards Bhima and just filled his body with water so that at least it was wet and the fire did not burn him. And then Krishna and Arjuna ran towards him. And they told him that if this weapon could have been fought, we all would be fighting it. Don't be foolish and kill yourself, Krishna said, and pulled him down. And Bhima was proud, but he was not foolish. He also realized when the fire was burning him that I'll die if I do this. So he was not ready to go down himself. But when Krishna pulled, he did not resist. And then he came down. So at that time when they saw this weapon is so powerful, well, better not try to fight it. You get a feeler, so we have to use our feeler. We cannot approach life with like a one size fit all formula. This is what I'm going to do in all situations. No, if the situation has changed, let me do this. That's where our intelligence, our presence of mind, our resourcefulness comes into the picture. Does that answer your question?
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay. If any of you want to write chits and send the questions ahead also, that's also perfectly fine.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. we are talking about alter what we can change, accept what you can't change.
Hmm.
By altering, can we change the situation in our favor?
Hmm.
In that case, what will happen to performance? The performance is that matters. What will happen to our performance when we are altering the situation to our favor? By altering the situation to our favor, what will happen to our performance?
It will improve, isn't it? See, let me understand your question. You're saying that if we are meant to alter the things we can change,
yes,
then by altering, what will happen to our performance?
Yes.
Yes, definitely, it will improve.
But the question is whether the performance is not at all matter, but that will come.
No, performance is not all that matters.
All that matters.
That means it is not the only thing that matters.
Yes, correct.
But performance does matter. Say, for example, a simple example could be, say, if we are driving a car,
yes,
and it becomes very stormy, the road becomes slippery. And then at that time, we can't change the fact that there is a storm. That is, we have to accept.
Yes.
What can alter is, let me drive slowly.
Yes.
Let me carefully look at the road to see if any potholes, any ditches, anything dangerous on the road. Then when I do that, my performance will also change in the sense that I'm not driving that fast, but I'll be driving slower but safer. And if I had not altered myself, I might meet with the accident. But if I alter the way I drive, I may not meet with the accident.
But in that case, situation is not changed.
Yes.
Situation is not changed in our favor.
Okay. So, can the situation be changed in our favor? Yes, that's another, you could give an example. Say, suppose it's something very simple. Say, somebody is very angry with us and they are yelling at us. And we get angry and we start yelling at them. And then what happens is, what is a small argument soon snowballs into like a world war. But if at that time we stay calm and maybe we try to pacify the person, we try to inform and say something which is reasonable. And suppose that person may understand, oh, it was like this, I didn't know it was like that. And their anger also disappears. Then the situation can be diffused. Not only does our actions change, we change, but we can change the situation also. So now, sometimes we might speak something reasonable and the other person may give up their anger. And sometimes they may not give up their anger also. So if they're not giving up their anger, that means we could say there's destiny involved. This person is going to be short-tempered and I'm going to have to deal with that situation. But sometimes we might be able to change. That's why when we are acting, how much of a positive result we get, we don't know. The positive result could be altering of the situation, or it may not be, at least we don't worsen the situation.
We are not bothered about the results actually.
Well, I won't go so far to say we are not bothered about the result. Certainly we are concerned,
yes,
about the result.
Yes.
But it is that we shouldn't be attached to the results.
Yes.
That's a very important point, you brought it up. So there's a difference between goals and results. And I was talking at MIT 2 years ago. And there are one professor said, listen, I read this Bhagavad-Gītā. But it says work without worrying about the results. He says, I find this completely impractical. He says, we work for the results. How can you work without attachment to the results? So then I explained at that time, there is a difference between goals and results. The Bhagavad-Gītā is not against setting goals. In fact, just after speaking the Bhagavad-Gītā, when the Kurukshetra war started, every day the Pandavas would set goals. Today we will fight against this battalion. Today we will attack this enemy. Most famously on the 14th day, Arjuna said that today I will bring down Jayadrath or I will enter fire. So when Arjuna is setting goals like this, Krishna is not telling him, hey, you forgot Karmanyavadhikaraste. You forgot my teaching in the Bhagavad-Gītā. He doesn't say that. Why? Because the point here is that goals are what we set before we do our work. Results are what we get after we have done the work. So setting goals inspires us to work wholeheartedly. And in that sense, setting goals is good. Because to the extent we have some inspiring vision of what we want to achieve, to that extent we feel motivated to commit ourselves, to work hard. So setting goals is desirable. But after we have done our work, then we let go. Okay, now I have done my part. If the result is going to manifest, it will. If not, let go. So in this karma, daiva, kala and phala. Now when we are doing karma, we do want the phala. We do care for the phala. Isn't it? Say if somebody is cooking food and they say, I don't care about the quality of food. I am following Bhagavad Gita, I am detached. That will not work, isn't it? We are definitely concerned. We want to cook the food as well as possible. So while doing karma, we do want the phala. It's not that we don't care about the phala. But sometimes if the phala doesn't come, we are not obsessed with that. So we are concerned about the fruits, but we are not obsessed or attached to the fruits. Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Hare Krishna. Actually, I don't know, I may sound stupid, not very much into this, but you said that our actions, our bring the consequences, what was that? So that may, it means like we are the maker of our destiny as well, because if our actions are bringing the consequences, then at the end of the day, destiny doesn't matter.
Okay, good question. So, if our actions lead to the results, then destiny doesn't matter. Because we are the makers of our destiny. Yes, see, we are the makers of our destiny, but we are not the masters of our destiny. Mm-hmm. What is the difference? That means our actions will produce the results. Mm-hmm. And that's now whatever I am calling as my destiny, that has also been produced by my past actions. If somebody is born in a wealthy family, if somebody is born in a poor family, that's destiny. But why is the destiny like that? Because the person who was born in a wealthy family did good karma in the past lives. The person who was born in a poor family did not do such good karma in the past lives. So in that sense, we are the makers of our destiny. But we are not the masters in the sense that how destiny is going to manifest when in our lives. That we don't determine. That means if I do good, I will get good. But when I will get that good, I don't control that. I might do good right now, I might get good right now. I might do good now and I might get good after 10 lifetimes. And in that sense, say if you consider a cricket match. Say, sometimes a player is out and the player is declared not out. And sometimes the player is not out and the player is declared out. Now overall you could say, that destiny evens out. If a player plays for 15 years, then the number of times when he's wrongly judged out and wrongly judged not out when he's out, they will even out. But you know, all wrong judgments don't count the same thing, same magnitude. Sometimes if it's in the critical phase of a match and the player is leading the team to victory and that time they get a wrong decision. And another player, then the team is well on a winning situation, and even if that player gets out, other players will take care of things. So when that right or wrong decision comes, that matters a lot also. So similarly for us, yes, we are the makers of our destiny, no doubt. So and that when we say we are the makers of our destiny, that it should inspire us to do our best in all situations. But we are not the masters in the sense that sometimes despite doing our best, we might not get the best results. We might not even get good results. We might get bad results. So in that sense, we are not the masters. Okay. Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, please.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. So for yes. Devotees, as we have Krishna in the center, how much destiny... how much destiny plays a role?
Okay. How much does destiny play a role? Because as devotees, we have Krishna in the center. There are two broad ways of looking at it. I'll explain both and then I will reconcile the two. One is that the laws of material nature are impartial. They are going to act. So if we consider the law of gravity, if a devotee steps off a 10-story building, well, I'm a devotee, so what, the law of gravity is going to act.
So, whether you are a devotee or not devotee, the laws are impartial. So if
we go out in cold weather without warm clothes, we'll get sick. So we could say that the laws of material nature are impartial, and whether a devotee or non-devotee doesn't matter. That's you could say the mechanical way of looking at things. And it has validity also. But the other way is that we can say that when we surrender to Krishna, Krishna protects us and Krishna takes away all the sinful reactions. And we are in Krishna's care. So whatever happens to us is by Krishna's plan. So then a devotee is not under karma at all. Devotee is under Krishna's care. Then we may say, then why is a devotee, sometimes devotees also still have problems. Why do they have problems then? Then we could say it's Krishna's plan, maybe for their purification, for their glorification. For the Pandavas, they were great devotees. Ram is the Lord himself. But Ram had to be exiled. Ram had to be separated from his wife. It was agonizing for him. Why did he have to go through all that? Because that is for teaching all of us how to face adversity with dignity. So this could be another extreme that actually there is no karma for a devotee. If devotee goes through difficulty, it is just for their glorification, for instruction, for setting an inspiring example for others. Now, in between these two is the understanding, which is so that this understanding is also true, this is also true. But what is important is that we are neither here nor there. We are not pure devotees who are acting only for Krishna's pleasure. We also have our own self-centered desires. We also have our own agendas. So therefore, as devotees, we shouldn't think that we are beyond karma. That if a devotee faces some problems, then the devotee's humility is that devotee thinks that, oh, it's my own karma because of his suffering. I have done so much sinful activities, because of that I am suffering. And the devotee thinks, I'll talk about how to see things positively in the next session, but broadly devotee thinks that although I am so sinful, still Krishna is giving me an opportunity to practice bhakti. Krishna is so kind, let me take shelter of Krishna. So once I was giving a class on karma in a college in India. And after that, one boy asked this question. He said that, you say that it is because of bad karma we suffer in life. He said, I saw that you had to walk with crutches. And so, if you are lame, that means you must have done some bad karma. And if you have done some bad karma, then what right do you have to instruct us about karma? So then I replied, yes, I had done many, many bad karmas, but God is so kind that he engages people even like me in his service. You have not done any bad karma like me. If you become engaged in service, you can do much more service. So the point which I'm making here is that as devotees, we don't think that we are beyond karma. And okay, if I'm suffering, it's my karma, but Krishna is still giving me an opportunity to serve. And that is Krishna's mercy. And by serving him, I'll go beyond karma. But it is very inappropriate for us to apply that to somebody else. Say, if we are serving some senior devotee, and we respect that devotee, and that devotee also, we see them very dedicated, very advanced. And then say that devotee gets cancer. And then if we start thinking, I thought you were a great devotee, but if you are getting cancer, that means you must have done some terrible karma. And I was mistaken to think you were such a great devotee. No, we should never think like that. We should think at that time that, okay, I don't know why this devotee has got cancer specifically, but let me see this as an opportunity to serve this devotee. Let me serve this devotee, and that way I can move closer to Krishna. I can assist this devotee has helped me in my past, so let me help them now. So basically this is that a devotee should be able to translate life situations in a way that is favorable for our bhakti. Mm. So if I am going through difficulty, I shouldn't think, oh, I'm a pure devotee, why am I suffering like this? Krishna is unfair. No, I must have done many bad karmas, but still Krishna is giving me opportunity to serve him. But if it's some other devotee, you should think, not that they are sinful, that's why they are suffering. So this is with respect to attitude. But with going further, when we practice Krishna Bhakti, see, the suffering doesn't come just because of the situation. The suffering also comes based on our attitude towards the situation. So suppose somebody is sick and they are in pain. Now if they constantly keep thinking about their sickness, their pain will multiply enormously. But if they don't think so much about the sickness, okay, I'm sick, I'm in bed, but let me think about, you know, what can I do in this, maybe I can read something, maybe I can hear something, and they get out of themselves, then they will not feel that much pain. So basically we could say that Krishna gives us the means by which we can transcend our pain. That means the Madhva Sampradaya gives a nice example, which I'll conclude this session and then we'll have a break, that, or after a few questions, either way. That suppose there is a child who has not done the homework and the teacher is very strict. So if the child has not done the homework, the teacher says, have you not done your homework? No. Okay, come here, show your hand. And tack, tack, tack. They beat with a stick. Now, of course, today it will be considered abusive. But but anyway, there's a strict teacher like that. Now, the mother knows that the child has not done the homework. The mother knows that the teacher is strict. The mother, at one level, doesn't want the child to be punished. Doesn't the child want to be hurt? At the same time, the mother doesn't want the child to also become lazy and irresponsible. So, before the child goes to school, what the mother does is, put a nice thick glove on the child's hands. When the child goes to school, have you done your homework? No. Come here. Show your hand. He shows the hand. The teacher beats. And the stick hits, but it doesn't hurt. It hits, but doesn't hurt. Noise comes, but the pain doesn't come. So, the example is that the teacher is like material nature. Krishna is like the mother. And we are like that student, that child. And the glow is Krishna consciousness. If we remember Krishna, although life's troubles will hit us, they won't hurt us that much. Because the problem that we go through, if we are thinking about the problem constantly, it becomes worse. But if you're thinking about Krishna, okay, this problem is there. Thinking about Krishna gives satisfaction. So somebody might be in pain, but a materialistic person might just scream and squeal. They may grunt in pain. A devotee will call out Krishna. And in that calling out to Krishna, in that remembrance of Krishna, there will be some relief. So, what Krishna primarily gives us is, sometimes Krishna may just, like the mother tells the teacher, please excuse my child. Krishna can do that also. But a devotee doesn't demand that from, that the Lord do that for him. But what Krishna does is, gives us the glove. If we put on the glove, if we remember Krishna, then even amidst difficulty, we won't suffer that much. We won't go through that much pain. So that's what we can surely expect from our bhakti. Our karma Krishna may or may not take away. We don't know what Krishna will do. But what Krishna will surely give us is the opportunity to remember him. So then what will happen is, we may have to live with pain, but we don't have to live in pain. That pain will be a part of our life, but it won't consume our life. So unfortunately, suppose the child is going to school and the child thinks, hey, this glove is so big and heavy, why do they need to carry it? Child takes it out and throws it away. And then the stick hits. And it hurts quite badly also. So like that, in normal times in our life, we start thinking, hey, why do I need to be so serious about Krishna consciousness? It doesn't matter, you just put it aside. And then when the school of hard knock starts, hey, Krishna, help! It will become like that. So if we take shelter of Krishna, then life's problems will hit us, but they won't hurt us that much. Okay? So thank you very much. And we will have, is Krishna Chandra Prabhu here? Okay.
We can have a break now.
We can have a break now?
Yeah.
Okay. So thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki. Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki. Gaur Premanande.